The following days passed quickly for Adam. He slept, he ate, and he worked out in between lessons on Chilvanti writing from Popper. He settled right into the familiar lifestyle of a soldier, even taking up some basic chores in cleaning the pod bay. The occasional moments alone he got with Ferry served quite well to spice up the otherwise boring period of time. Major Grimm had only shown herself twice over the short trip, coming by first to discuss Adam and Ferry's budding relationship, confirming that it wouldn't cause any issues within the team. The second time she rolled around, she had dark blue bags under her eyes, and notified the team that they were less than 8 hours away from the point where they disembark on the shuttle for their base on Fayara. When Adam asked if she was okay, she had blearily turned to him and uttered a single word. Paperwork. Leaving the Major to her undoubtedly mountainous pile of paperwork for their botched operation in Cheyenne, Adam packed his few belongings into his rucksack and sat on his bunk, listening to Ferry and Slip debate the merits of the Imperium's HSR-11 versus the HSC-9. "Listen," Ferry said. "All I'm saying is that more power is always better. Wait, be damned." "See, you say that until you've been running for 4 kilometers, then that extra 6 pounds start to feel more like 20. Slip waved dismissively before continuing. "With the C-9, you get almost as much power for nearly half the weight. Also, when you have the clear rooms, its shorter barrel helps avoid running into objects. Like that time you knocked that statue over in L.A. She finished that remark with a satisfied grin. Adam chuckled to himself before tuning them out again. He had personally never used either rifle, but he had seen them. If he had to pick one to use, he'd probably go with Slip and pick the C-9. It vaguely resembled several sci-fi firearms he'd seen in movies. It was only slightly larger and longer than his own carbine. He was shaken from his thoughts when a voice came over the intercom in the ship. "Attention crew, the Valiant Sabre will be coming out of phase in 30 seconds. Please brace for emergence." The denizens of Pod 7 all stood from their bunks in a practice manoeuvre and grabbed the thin rails that ran across the room horizontally above the heads of their beds. Adam followed suit, throwing his rucksack that now contained his plate carrier, battle belt, and the gym clothes that had been lent to him by Slip over his shoulder. He was dressed in his newly cleaned Cayman pants, a tan undershirt, and a green flannel top. Grabbing the handle, he patiently waited for the jerk that he had been told came from dropping out of Slip space. He prepared wrong, as the powerful momentum shift that came from dropping out of faster-than-light travel sent him towards the wall instead of away from it, as he expected. This blunder, followed by the ensuing thunk of his right shoulder meeting the wall, elicited a chuckle from the bay. To his surprise, even the ever-mysterious Classy was even quietly chuckling and shaking her head. As the team removed their hands from the grips, the door stood open to reveal Grimm in her brass chest-plated dress uniform. "All right, ladies, let's get to the shuttle. We need to get planet side as soon as possible so I can get my ass chewed out by the brass." She said this in a jovial tone, but Adam saw the slight glint of fear in her eyes before she turned and led the team out of the bay. As they moved to disembark the frigate, Adam had a moment of panic that his rifle was being left behind. He tapped Popper on the shoulder, and she turned to him with a raised brow. "What about our weapons?" he asked furtively, glancing back the way they'd come. "I'm kind of attached to my carbine, and I'd like it to not be lost on some ship several light years away." "Don't worry, big man," she said with a chuckle. "The armor is directly attached to our pod. After we get dropped off, the shuttle will head back and pick her up, along with all our weapons up for storage on base." She leaned in a little closer as they walked, now shoulder to shoulder in the hall that led to the frigate's hangar bay. "We all get a little attached to our weapons so they come with us wherever we go." Nodding, Adam breathed a sigh of relief. He had been through over 4 years of hell with that rifle. The thought of having it disappear into the ether almost felt like losing a friend. They loaded onto the shuttle and closed the door behind them. The clunk of the landing gear retracting into the craft heralded the fact that Adam was about to get his first taste of an honest-to-God alien world. The other commandos all wore a modified version of the fatigues that the Chilvanti wore when not clad in armor. Instead of the standard grey and brown coloration, theirs are a mottling of greens, browns, tans, and black, in alternating swathes of digital and smooth, paintbrush-like patterns. The digital portion of their uniform was vaguely reminiscent of Marpat, if a lighter shade, which was offset by the brushstrokes that seemed to glide over the pattern from below. Frankly, he loved it, and couldn't wait to get a set of his own. When the radio crackled overhead that they were 30 seconds out from their location, Slip shot him a grin and opened the side door, revealing Adam's first sunset, or sunrise, on an alien world. He was awestruck by what he saw. The Shill had set up their military base in a coastal and tropical region, with green covering the landscape surrounding the squat, large buildings of the base. In the distance, the green faded to a strip of tan and then a deep blue, accented with the red of the alien sun on the horizon. It reminded Adam of some of the postcards he'd seen of places like Hawaii or Tahiti back on Earth. "Holy fuck," he said, barely audible over the roaring warm and humid winds that poured into the cabin. "I know, right?" shouted Slip, clearly enjoying his reaction to the landscape below. As they banked and headed down into the military base, Adam's view of the sun and sea was cut off by the green, and eventually, a large purple building with gold trim. As they fired out of the aircraft, the Major put a hand on Adam's shoulder. "Adam, you're with me for the time being. We need to go get you a biometric ID for your time on base," Grim said, beckoning him to follow. "Yes, ma'am." "Pass your bag off the ferry. She'll get it set up in your room for when we get back." He did as ordered, handing it to the large woman who took it with a mischievous grin. Ignoring that, he followed the Major to a parked car, mentally preparing himself for several hours of bureaucratic hell. Now in his room several hours later, he discovered that his bag had indeed been rifled through. His plate carrier and battle belt sat on the small writing desk in the corner of the small room. His gym clothes sat folded on a squat but long dresser in the back of the small domicile, and his green gas mask bag hung from the corner of the bed. The room reminded him vaguely of the barracks he stayed in during his time in the army, except that the walls were made from the purple composite the shield seemed to construct everything from. In the back of the room sat a doorway that led to a personal bathroom, complete with a shower, toilet, and vanity. Sitting on his bed, he contemplated what to do next. But the Major had dropped him here, she'd given him no orders, and left him to his own devices. Their meeting had gone well, getting a picture taken, blood sample pulled, an immunization shot for something, followed by biometric scans for fingerprints, retinas, and facial makeup. The whole process was smooth and surprisingly user-friendly. What wasn't user-friendly was the nearly 2 hours of waiting in the lobby of the office before a Shilvanti male came out with his card. In passing, the male had quietly asked if he was really a death's head, to which Adam just shrugged, taking the non-committal route. Sitting in the room with his card in hand, he looked it over. It had several computer chips embedded on it, each one looking similar to the ones used on credit cards before the invasion. Next to the small chipset was his picture, biometric description, including even his weight, and a clearance code that he didn't quite understand yet. Popper's lessons in shul writing had paid off, and he was able to identify most of the signs around base, even after just a few days of learning. He had always had a knack for languages, as growing up with a Russian mother and a half-Scottish, half-German father in the central United States had started him on a trilingual path in life early. He had just put his card back in his pocket when Ferry waltzed into the room, grinning widely. "Uh-oh," he thought. "I know that look. She's up to something." "So, Adam, it occurs to me that you don't have any clothes," she said, her grin turning almost predatory. "And, more importantly, that you wouldn't know where to buy said clothes."
What did you have in mind, Ferry?"
"Well, there's this lovely mall just off base with a couple male-focused clothing shops in it. Come on, I'll take you there. It'll be fun," she said, beckoning him from here he sat.
"Great. She wants to play dress-up."
"No," said Adam, staring at what he could only assume was a male version of Victoria's Secret. Ferry had dragged him to the store after stopping at a more generalized one, where he picked out two sets of shorts, pants, and a few sets of boxers that he hoped would fit. The male attendant had seemed shocked at the idea that another male could be built like Adam, and had directed him to a section that seemed to be gender-neutral. The pants and shorts were made of a material that vaguely resembled jeans, but with significantly more stretch to them. He picked out a few pairs of plain white and black t-shirts, and thankfully Ferry had paid for it all, citing the fact that Adam didn't yet have a shul credit sheet. However, she demanded that he come with her to this location as repayment for the small expenditure at the generic store within the mall. At first he thought it would be fine, but noticing the male mannequins on the storefront dressed in overly complex lingerie, he was not having it. "Come on, it'll be fun. It's not exclusively lingerie they sell here, you know," she said, pulling him towards the entrance, despite his half-hearted attempts to free himself. In truth, he owed her, and didn't care if she wanted to buy him skimpy lingerie. At least, not in theory. In practicality, it just felt wrong. He'd gotten used to the whole matriarchal society shtick early on, but some parts still made his head spin. It wasn't like he hadn't gone to these kinds of stores with women he dated in the past, but it was always on the other side of things looking in. Now, having been pulled past the threshold of the doorway, his eyes settled on a small group of males looking at him with wide eyes. He gave the rather androgynous-looking group a smile before falling into place with Ferry, who was beelining for a section loaded with crop tops. His eyes, on the other hand, settled on the more modest section of the store, with one of the half-mannequins wearing a tight-fitting spandex set of boxers, whose fabric extended to just above the knee. Those had always been the most comfortable in the field, and he pulled Ferry in that direction. Flagging down a rather shocked male attendant, he pointed to the underwear and asked if they would have it in his size. The male nodded, and scurried off to the back of the store, probably having to pull them from some hole they'd been stored in, since males didn't really come in his size among the shill.
"You're kidding me, Adam," said Ferry disappointedly.
"We're standing in an entire store full of clothes that will look gorgeous on you, and you pick out the one item that isn't remotely sexy?" Adam relented upon seeing her dejected and pouty gaze. Sighing heavily, he put his hand to his forehead and decided to throw her a bone. "Tell you what, you buy these for me and I'll let you pick out one. I cannot stress this enough, one of those crop tops over there," he sighed, knowing that might not be enough to assuage her. "And I'll wear it on the date we discussed earlier during the ride over here."
"Really?" she said, instantly perking up.
Groaning audibly, with a hand over his face to cover his rapidly heating cheeks, he nodded. After which he practically sprinted over to the section and began to rifle through the drawers while Adam waited for the attendant to return.
Are you a human?"
A soft voice came from behind him. Turning rapidly to find himself staring into the face of the four Shulvanti males, which he now identified were barely out of their teens, if even that.
"Yeah, I am. What can I do for you?"
"I didn't think they were letting you off Earth yet," said one of the males,
before having his arm slapped by another who chided him.
"That's rude. You can't just say that."
"But it's true," the first male responded, seeming slightly offended.
"Well," said Adam, furrowing his brow, "I'm kind of a special case. Got a hot girlfriend who will be back," he said, gesturing at Ferry, now seeming to have settled on a small black number.
"Sorry, boys, but I gotta get back to her now. You know how women can be." The males all seemed to nod in agreement before returning to their shopping. Adam was thankful. He really didn't want to be part of that conversation any longer. As it turned out, not only had his, now that he thought about it, Shulvanti girlfriend picked up the number, but she had also collected the several pairs of underwear from the returning attendant, and was currently paying for the items. Falling in beside her as she collected the bagged items, he asked,
"Great, can we go now? I didn't even like moors back on Earth, where I wasn't a walking freak show."
"Fine, we'll head back," she said, sounding slightly sarcastic, grinning wildly at him.
After a brief incident with the gate guards questioning the validity of Adam's newly minted military ID, they had returned to the barracks. Adam had deposited his clothes in the dresser, despite Ferry's pleas for him to try on the top she'd bought for him. After convincing her it would be more fun to wait and see on their date, she'd gone back to her room when Adam told her he wanted to get in a quick workout before heading to bed. He then got ready to head to the gym downstairs, pulling his clothes from where they rested in the long and squat dresser. He stuck with the black basketball shorts, but instead combined them with one of the black t-shirts he had picked out. He ran into Slip on his way out, who happened to also be on her way to the gym, dressed in the same pair of basketball shorts Adam was, along with a half shirt, half sports bra contraption that exposed her midriff and drew Adam's gaze to her smaller than normal assets. Following her down, they walked in companionable silence until they reached the gym entrance. The weight racks in the room seemed fairly similar to what existed on Earth. He made tracks for the alien version of a bench press, only to be jerked violently to one side by Slip, who had a malicious glint in her eyes.
"Not so fast there, tough guy. Remember what I said before, Shaheen?"
Can't say I do," replied Adam,
racking his brain to remember the conversation that had taken place less than a week earlier.
"You, me, and the sparring ring," she said,
pulling two sets of padded gloves from her gym bag.
"Right now."
"Oh, great. She wants to fight."